This PMI North India presents its first webinar. The title of webinar is 7 Quality Mindset Prompts, presented by Mr. Dinesh Bhrushundi. Mr. Dinesh Bhrushundi is an industrial expert and has 28 years of experience in automotive and construction industry. Currently, he is working as Chief Terminal Operations Officer at Indira Gandhi International Airport. He's an expert in quality assurance, service delivery, knowledge management, and business excellence. Dinesh, over to you.
Great. So let me begin with the first slide of mine. And if you see the right side bottom corner, it says, appreciate you taking time out on this second Saturday afternoon. Thank you so very much. With the kind of weather around, one would have preferred not to get onto this, but really appreciate taking time and joining it here. Thank you so much. So from the bottom right corner, let me move to the left top corner at the outset. So let me begin with this Sanskrit scripture. Om Sahana Vatu Sahano Bhunaktu Sahabiryam Karvavahi Tejasvina Vadhitamastu Mavit Vishavahi. So it expands like, let's stay together. Let's enjoy the fruits of the act of bravery is done together. Let's look forward to a light sharing the hatred between all of us. So it typifies the working between two individuals, or it is expanded, it works, expands to the working between a set of people. That's the team PMI we are today. So I, Dinesh Bhrushundi, welcome you to this event. Sincerely welcome all of you to this event. Bhrushundi is a compound Sanskrit word, Bhru meaning forehead and Shundi meaning trunk. And that's precisely the name of Lord Ganesha. It's a coincidence, and thanks for the PMI team for making sure that the first inaugural webinar of the session or the series of the webinars starts with the Bhrushundi or the namesake of the Lord Ganesha. Let me talk the context further. So these are the four sites for foresight, which I developed over a period of time. I am having a background in quality. So 7 QC tools is the first site, the new 7 or the 7 management tools is the second site. View 7 is a set of tools which I have developed over a period of time, which is typically goes for training people on observation stimuli, how to make powerful and productive observations. And the one, the topic today is Mu 7, the 7 mindset prompts. Let me give a little prelude about mindset. If this would have been a live session, what I would have done is a small game with the subject, which would have been selected from the audience to illustrate the concept. I would have asked the subject to repeat the word silk 10 times, and all of you can try do this in mind loudly and rhythmatically. Rule of the game is, I will be counting 10 instances and ask a question at the 11th instance. The subject has to give top of mind answer in flow immediately as 12th answer. So if I ask subject to do this silk word 10 times, and the question I ask that what does cow drink, invariably the answer is milk instead of water. What happens is a temporary preconditioning of mind, because of the word silk, a sample or the subject is enticed into finding out an answer which is rhyming with silk and something has to do with cow and something has to do with the drink. And that's how it is. All of us are subjected so much and so many times to this temporary permanent preconditioning or the conditioning of mind, and that's the mindset. So this is a set of tools or the prompts which I have developed, which has been going into my mind, making sure that my habits are refined or replaced from the old habits, give me a kind of a effective personal self-management kind of a way forward. And I'm pretty sure that if you do the sacrosanct inclusion of this new 7 in your work ethos, it will be slowly and steadily establish a kind of an auto trigger in your minds, which will be giving you these right prompts at the right times, depending on the situation. Let me talk about this Mu 7 construct. It's very simple. The 7 letters, which are A, B, C, D, E, and E, are arranged in pairs with a gap in between. And I'm just putting a 2 to connect them. So it becomes A to A, B to B, C to C, D to D, E to E, F to F, and G to G. The idea here is on this slide, but let me give a disclaimer. I appreciate from bottom of my heart a huge collective experience of the participants, which is on the other side. I acknowledge all of you already know what is being showcased here in some form or other. I aspire still to make an humble attempt to put how I perceive these in a particular perspective and articulate so that they serve as an 8A memoir to you. So A2A is adult to adult, B2B is back to basics, C2C is connect to customers, D2D is data to decide, E2E is end to end, F2F is face to face, and G2G is go to Gemba. And let me illustrate these ones as we go into the slides which follow. The first mindset prompt, A2A or adult to adult, comes from a concept of transaction analysis, which was given to the world by Dr. Eric Byrne. He postulates that as we grow from our childhood to adulthood, we keep observing different interactions which happen around us. Communication typically is referred to as transactions, a stimuli and a response. So he categorized this set of communications or transaction into three different states of ego, as he called them. So for example, if I'm saying do it, if I'm saying sit down, if I am saying work out, if I saying go study, these are the typical instructions which will be coming from our parents, our teachers, or our seniors. So these are classified as the parent status of ego kind of stimuli. If somebody tells me don't go out in the hot sun, and I say no, I will go because I enjoy hot sun, this will be a state of ego of child which will be getting a stimuli activated from me. And that's the typical creativity, the enjoyment, the effervescence, a kind of a rebel. This is normally comes from a child state of ego. So continuing with our instructions, don't go in hot sun, a typical parent instruction reacted by a child saying that no, I will go because I enjoy hot sun, followed by this third set of instruction, right? If you want to go, but think about it. If you go out, it will tan your skin. It will dehydrate you. It can cause you damage. Will you still like to go? This is a instruction or a transaction or a stimuli which is coming out of a basic logic and reasoning. And all of you can immediately agree with me that the adults speak like this. So if you see the right hand side of the slide, it says the A2A typifies logic and reasoning, and in my viewpoint is the best suited component for business communication. However, other two have their roles too. For example, the innovation, creativity, exploration would be child, and the experiential learning will be brought in this. So the typical formula which I have been thinking about using, and I have been using it actually, is about 60 to 70% of the business communication, if it is maintained at a level of A2A, and remaining are plugged in and plowed in as and when required, it always is a good idea. Most of the time, if someone in front of you goes to a child state of ego, let me just take a step back. These two figures which have been shown there, they are two individuals actually, and each one will have these three states of ego, and the interactions will happen parent to parent, parent to child, adult to adult, and child to adult, and child to parent. The ones which I was trying to demonstrate actually by saying that out. So the communication, if it goes, for example, adult to child, one can always pull it back by quickly going to parent and pulling a child to adult. So how do we articulate our conversation? How do we choose words? How do we choose our gestures so that we maintain the communication level at A2A? It's best to be learned actually by practice. So one can use this A2A as a prompt, as a background. If somebody is going to a child state of ego and trying to pull you to the child state of ego, and should you go there, the entire communication, the transaction would be unproductive. It will be argumentative, it will be leading into differences which are good at sometimes, just not good at sometimes, most of the times. So all these things one has to see, and at an appropriate time this prompt has to trigger a signal within yourself saying that it's the time to pull the conversation back into A2A so that the entire communication is most productive. All right, great. So going to the next prompt, the second prompt is back to basic. Let me tell you a story to begin. An MBA and a BE student go on a camping trip. They are tired too much. So very early they set up their tent, eat their food and fall asleep. Some hours later, the BE wakes up, his MBA friend, and says, "Look up at the sky and tell me what you see." The MBA replies, "I see millions of stars." The BE asks, "What does that tell you?" The MBA ponders for a minute and says, "Astronomically speaking, it tells me that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. Astrologically, it tells me that the Saturn is in Leo. Theologically, I bow down to the Almighty, saying that it's evident that the Lord is all powerful and we are small and insignificant. And meteorologically speaking, it seems we'll have a beautiful day tomorrow." "And what does it tell you?" he asks B. The B is silent for a moment and speaks. "Practically speaking, someone has stolen our tent." The debrief I take from this story is that let huge knowledge and the vast information which we gather from place to place, from conversation to conversation, not take the eye off the ground reality. Begin with basics and build on if and to the extent required. I always remember that as a student in the in my college and school, if I have missed on a basic formula, a formula, I would go back to the basics and start calculating from the basics. So it's always a good idea to start on basics, build on them. Obviously, there is no need for rediscovering the wheel, but this prompt will tell you that at point in time, it will be a good idea that you must have to come back to your roots, come back to your basics to be able to build it, build the thing on further. Let me illustrate this with one more story. There's a story of a visitor who has gone to a mental asylum, and as he's taking around, what he sees is there is a person who is looking like a professor. He gets curious and he goes up to him and he says that you are looking like a professor. He says, "Looking like? I am a professor. I used to teach in a college. What happened? I don't know what this authorities of this asylum has thought, but they got me in here." Said, "Okay, I can help you getting out of this place. Should you demonstrate to me your intellect? He says, "No problem. Ask me a question." So the visitor asked a question saying that what time it is now. No sooner than this question is asked, the inmate of the mental asylum vanishes into the room, takes about a couple of minutes to come back. He comes back with a big box and starts taking out different instruments and equipments out of that. He takes a couple of pins out, then the measuring tape, then he takes the calculator, a piece of paper, a pencil. He puts those two pins on the ground, looking at some area where there's a sunshine. Then he measures the length of shadows, does some calculation, and looks at the guest and says, "Well, it is about to be 12 o'clock today, 12 p.m. today." Now, the guest has got another question immediately. He says that, "Very good. I appreciate that you have a real good knowledge of the subject. However, if there are no shadows and there is no sun, what do you do?" And he says, "Look, now I think that you should be into the asylum and I should be out." He tells the guest, he said, "If there are no shadows and no sun, I'll be simply looking at my watch and tell the time." The learning is a simple watch and not the set of tool is required. The issue is as simple as telling the time. You decide. I prescribe is not the right word. I follow a basic 80-16-3-1 rule, which is a triple application of Pareto's principle. You must be knowing about it, 80-20 rule as they call it. Out of the 100 issues we confront, 80 issues are resolvable by some basic tools, tackles, techniques, thought processes. 16 might require a little bit of an advanced thinking. Three require a further granularized treatment. And only one out of 100, in my viewpoint, would require some kind of a breakthrough technique. So let's be cognizant of this fact. And this is a practical learning out of my 40 years of experience so far. And one can take it. What's the takeaway? Takeaway is practice to perfect. The B2B must continue till this B2B is very strongly ingrained on our minds and it is instinctively reflected in our actions. What does that mean? That if a situation warrants a particular use of a technique or a tool or something like a thought process, then only I get that. Otherwise, I just stay with my basics. Agree? Let's move to other one. The third mindset problem, and all of us are aware of this, is connect to customer. So when I got into the early days of my career, maybe Yamaha, when I was into a middle management position, there used to be a question who would be asked by our seniors, who pays the worth for the work delivered? Salary for employed and invoices for self-employed. And I used to get answers like, my HR pays, I am paid by time office, etc., etc. Obviously, the answer is that your customer pays for your salary or your work, worth of your work. The next question which used to be asked was, how do you bring your customer in to your organization? So these were the two acronyms which I was introduced to, which is SIPOC and COPIS. All of us are aware of that. Supplier, input, process, output, and C, and the reverse of that. So SIPOC was developed in earlier days with a product out concept. It stays still, but in the recent times, we look at a customer and make the solutions according to him. So COPIS is predominant. Now, customer is ready to pay for the value proposition in your products or processes or projects or whatever you are doing to deliver it to him. He is not going to pay for the waste. The wastes in the organizations are best described by a concept of downtime. D determines the waste of defect. O is the overproduction. W is waiting time. N is non-utilization of the resources, the human resources typically. Then you have got T, I, and ME. So it's a separate big discussion which can happen on that. So all these waste prompts, if they are required, I'll share this with Yogesh ji to be able to circulate to all of us. But this can be all downloaded from the net. So all the waste which is caused by this waste creator entities in the organization, the customer is not going to pay for it. Now, the basic question is, after we understood that customer is the person who pays for our salary and is not going to pay for the waste in our organization, our work, our projects, or our products, and that the SIPOC is a way of bringing the customer into the organization. How do I connect to the customers? Think customer value delivery, the 4I way. I start with myself, then I look at the immediate next person who is going to be taking a benefit or getting a benefit of my work, my internal customer, typically the employees within the organization. So if I talk about a SIPOC constant, the concept, anybody who is downstream in the SIPOC becomes my customer, and who is upstream becomes my supplier in the internal customer supplier situation. We generally appoint, for example, in automobile, we are intermediates. For example, in a project situation, we are contractors. So those become our intermediate customers and suppliers two at a time. And obviously, there is a final intended customer. So if you talk about these four I's and say that whatever I am doing, wherever I am in the value stream, how is that going to be contributing to my next internal customer? How is it going to be contributing to my intermediate customer? How is it going to be helping achieve the final requirements of my intended customer? And that's how you can connect to the customer. Another way of looking at it is like, how do you really drive the customer efficacy? So after having connected with the customer, a downtime concept is there, where you are going to be effectively delivering the product or a project or a process. You're going to do it efficiently. And most importantly, connecting to customer would bring in a lot of empathy into the system, understanding the other points of view, listening, etc., etc. And above all, you require a huge amount of energy. And where is that going to be coming from? So before I answer this question, I like to ask a question. Who is your first customer? So whenever I used to ask this question, the answer would come, my family, my boss, my customer, actually, my parents. And I would wonder that who is my first customer? Till such time, I kind of made a self-discovery about my first customer. And here we go. So this was the kind of answers I was getting. My boss, yes, of course, boss is the first customer. That's in a lighter vein, but this is the quote which I normally use. This is my own quote. Person in the mirror is your first customer. The welfare of this customer should be done like a warfare, and everything is fair in love and war, they say. Now, to be able to do my duties as a customer towards my actual intended customer or intermediate or internal customer, my family as customer, to my parents as my customer, to my boss as customer, if I am not mentally agile, physically well, if I am not in a good mood, will I be in position to do things effectively, efficiently, and empathetically? The answer is no. So the first and foremost important thing which I feel is to be understood is you yourself, the man in the mirror, the person in the mirror is your first customer, and take good care of this first customer to be able to serve the other customers better. So at the same time, never neglect this fifth eye in the maze of four eyes on the left hand side, as you see in the connect to customer bullet. So let me tell you a small anecdote. So this was a story when I was working with a company called New Holland Tractor, and we had a typical situation of developing 70 suppliers, 7 components, 7 months, and 700 components, and all of us, including me as an in charge of the supplier quality assurance department, we used to travel. 1990 situation. I was traveling from Indirapuram 5:30 in the morning to get out of the home 4:30, 3:30 I would be getting, 5:30 I would reach airport to catch 6:30 flight to Ahmedabad, go to Syntex. We were developing a roto-molded fuel tank for our product, tractor product then. Finish our work, come back at 8 o'clock, 7:45 to Ahmedabad airport, so that 8:45 flight I can catch and come back by about 10 o'clock to be able to be back home at 12 o'clock. One of those days, the flight from Ahmedabad was delayed indefinitely, and the time I had come back at home at about 3:30 a.m. in the morning went off. Morning about 4:30, I had got up on a previous day at 2:30, 3:30, and next day I could sleep at 4:30. When I got up in the morning, it was my daughter who was trying to wake me up and asking me, demanding from me rather, that I would request you to take me to school today. I said, I'm tired. That was a Saturday. And please ask your mother to do the needful. And she says, no, it's going to be there. And I kind of had fallen asleep. And after some time, she again insisted, now that you're going to take me to get bathe, and then you are going to make me up, and then you are going to take me to the school. I said, Marta kya na karta? Ultimately, I did that. And when we were on the way, I just asked. In fact, she only opened the conversation. She says, aap hamesha bolte ho, achche bachche jeet nahi karte. I never did that. I demanded a chocolate from you. Then I asked my daughter, that why did you do it today? She says, just recall, in last 15-20 days, you have not, talking to me is quite away. You have not even touched me, and that sentence touched me internally, inside, and I got this concept of the in-home customer. So these are my 5 eyes of the customer, and one has to stay connected to all these 5 customers. The takeaway I would be recommend is regular rhetoric and rituals of this C2C prompt is very essential, and we'll have to keep doing it till such time they become an innate source of our natural responses. Let us move to the next prompt, which is D2D, and it is data to decide. Most of us are knowing this famous personality called W. Edward Deming, and he has said one point in time, in God we trust. He says, all others bring data. There's a huge amount of sense in that, because despite the fact that we know that data is essential for deciding, most of our decisions are on the spur of moment. They are taken by whatever we perceive as the information, whatever picture we have got painted for ourselves by the people who are in front of us, and this is they are decisions. small to big decisions, it normally happens. The degree to which it is influencing this decision may vary, but it happens. So let me put a contemporary context to it. We all agree that data is the crux of the digital age, but despite that, the decisions aren't based on data. Normally it's legacy of experience, gut feeling, we know this, that it can be only a second and not the primary driver, but we fall in this trap of this. Added to that, this is another pitfall which one has to avoid. There are two pitfalls, important pitfalls when it comes to dealing with data. One has to avoid the speed with which the data is traveling today, the velocity, the different type of data which comes in, variety, and the veracity aspect, whether it is how authentic is the data is, which comes from social media, which comes from print media, which comes from hearsay, which comes from here, which comes from there. So these are the three V vortex we normally find ourselves trapped in, and it's very difficult to come out of that. Most of the times, many a times. There's another tendency of over-analyzing, and which is all of us know, is called as paralysis of analysis. So how do we combat this? In my viewpoint, sense making is the key. And this was one small acronym or whatever. I work for a company called Delhi International Airport Limited, that is DIAL, and I'm very fond of doing acronyms. So this acronym is around DIAL. This particular year was 100 years of the quality month. So they celebrate every second Thursday of month of November worldwide as a World Quality Day. This was the 100th time. So on this 100th birthday anniversary of World Quality Day, I coined this acronym. So how do you get data? How do you converse the data into set of information? How do you act on those information? So that's an action. How do you convert this action into learning? And how do you pull back this learning into your data? Data gathering and data analysis situations. So this is what is one way of sense making out of data. So data has to be converted into a set of information, set of actionable information, and action and learning has to precede the next cycle of data collection. If this is done on a regular basis, the things would be much simpler and much different. Here are my trusted teammates for a D2D test match. I am prompted to tell you the Akbar Birbal story here. Akbar was surrounded by the Navaratnas, and all of them used to always complain about Birbal. He says that what is so great about him. So when Tansen was talking about it, and he said Birbal was sent out by Akbar for something else, and then Tansen was asked that, look at that procession which is going, just go and tell me that this procession is going from which place to which place, find out about procession and come back. I want to know that where it is going and where it is coming from. So Tansen went out over there and he came back. It was Tansen or Todarmal, I don't remember that, but one of the nine Ratnas was making this grudge. The person comes back and says that, well, there's a big businessman in the town, XYZ, and his son is getting married, and that's how the procession is all about. Then Akbar asks him, how many people are there? How long is it going to take? Is it going to create a kind of a problem with the movement of people? And so many other questions. And the Todarmal or Tansen, whosoever was there, he didn't have any answer. He calls Birbal, asks Todarmal to keep quiet, and he sends Birbal that, I please go and find out things about that procession. Birbal comes back a little later. Takes more time than the first person, but then he comes out and he says, without being asked, he says, this is a procession of such and such person. Son is getting married to another big businessman who's into a nearby town. They will be doing about 1.5 kilometers of procession, taking about 30 minutes. There are X number of horses and N number of elephants in that. And the complete ceremony event would be lasting for about X, Y number of days. And then Akbar points out out at the other Navratna and say that this is the way the things are going to be. So here is the 11 teammates. Let me put it across. Have you heard about J.R. Kipling? He was a Nobel laureate, a poet in early 1900 century. The poem which was on my notepad on the first day of my graduate internship in Ashok Leyland read, "I keep six serving honest men. They taught me all I knew. Their names are what and why and when and how and where and who." So this was a typical 5W1H which was adopted by Japanese at a later date, 1960s. And I'm not pretty sure if J.R. Kipling had any reference of Birbal, because Birbal used to follow that during his days already. Here are five more beyond the 5W and 1H, which are manifestations of this 5W and 1H, which is how much, what, if, what else, so what, and last but not least, five, why. So this 11 teammates, some of them can assist us in data gathering, while others can support us to derive information for sense making, and most of us can help us inculcate this D2D orientation. And this is one takeaway which I like to leave with you when I conclude on this D2D or data to decide prompt. Let's go to the fifth mindset prompt, end to end. Let me start with an EYML, Escorts Yamaha Motor Limited, where I spend a good amount of time. Anecdote. I was working as a receiving inspection person, manager, and there was a reject which I was told coming from the line. So I went, looked at it, I could sense the problem. I came and instructed that we need to segregate all the stock. And that was a piece of information I passed on. The problem was solved, but it reappeared next day. So I checked up and I was told that anything and everything which was lying on the line and to the staging area was sorted out, but some material was issued from the stores. Okay, so please go sort it out and make sure that, think about all such places where the material is there. So all the material in stores was sorted out. The problem was solved for a couple of days. Then the problem came again. So there was a PPC, the production planning control area. The material was not from the incoming store, was not moved into the final store. That came in. Next was a material in transit between the supplier and us, and some material was still lying at supplier end, which perhaps was ignored or whatever. So despite the best sought efforts, but there was no end to problem whatsoever. And this was because all the ends were not really envisaged. I could not, or me and my people could not really envisage all the ends. And thus, all the errors could not be eliminated. They were not eliminated. So we have to envision, or we have to visualize in supply chain stream, the early point upstream and extreme end point downstream. Normally, these are missed. What happens is that what is immediately in front of the eyes, in front of the sight, is taken as the reality. The reality can be much beyond it. So the seeing beyond, beneath, these are the important aspect of looking at things in an end-to-end manner. And obviously, one has to also look at all significant intermediate endpoints. For me, end-to-end prompt is a very powerful tool of surveillance. There is a saying, you say out of sight, out of mind. If you just reverse this, it goes into sight, into the mind. Let me put one more perspective and then I'll talk about it. So end-to-end actually has no end, because the viewscape is always 360 degrees. It's a spherical viewscape. The horizon is not linear anymore. It is a circular, it is a spherical one. Now, all of us know that what we see, we have got a vision range of 120 degrees, something like 30 degrees on right hand side, 30 degrees on left hand side, a little more on down and a little less on up. So that gives a scoop of 120 degrees. So this is the scoop which is available for us to immediately collect information out of the of information, complete sphere of situation. So this is where the problem is. if we can really think about the 40 degrees and find ways and means. So one of the way I have developed is that when I walk during my routine checks at projects, I will be just taking a quick peep on left and right hand side by actually turning my head here and here. It gives me a little more peep. Maybe after about 8 or 10 such stations, I take a complete turn and see anything I have left at the back of my mind, or back of my body and back of my mind. Thus, this is one thing. Let me also put you across to a wobble dowel. So these are the dowels of wobbles, which can be very effectively used across this value stream or the supply chain stream. Let's look at that availability of element to adequately address the end requirement. So availability, adequacy. The people who are responsible for delivery across the supply chain or a project or a process or a product line, do they understand this? Many a times people understand, however they won't utilize this. So are they understanding? Are they using? Is it leading to effectiveness? So effectiveness and efficiency, all of us know this, but let me articulate it. Effectiveness is ability to meet the end purpose or the stated purpose, whereas efficiency is that this end purpose is met with the best or the optimal resources. So effectiveness and efficiency. And then after it has been done, from a learning standpoint, look at the improvement opportunity. So this is A, E, I, O, and U wobbles, which give you the dowels for making sure that we fit in the entire structure properly and firmly for the end-to-end prompt. The takeaway, everyone can create and use blueprint and checklist for his prompt his own way. And that's my recommendation, because one has got different situations. There's a wonderful book by Dr. Gavde called Managing by Checklist. In case you have gone through that, wonderful. Otherwise, maybe you can flip through sometime. The takeaway concludes like end-to-end, E2E, every day keeps the errors away. And let's move to the next prompt. The sixth mindset prompt is face-to-face. Let me talk about the three V's of communication. If I would have been into an actual situation, I would have done this exercise, which I would like to do virtually now. Normally, I write, scribble down a couple of words on board. So, for example, I would write two letters into for a word EDO, and then I will write another two letters for a word IT. And I'll ask people to just read and understand and appreciate meaning up to them. So, it's a meaning which has been understood by an individual after reading these words. Then, what I do is to ask them to close their eyes, and I utter this word two or three different ways. For example, do it. For example, do it. For example, do it. So there is a vocal connotation which is getting added. And then I ask people or the subject or the participant to open their eyes, and I say, do it or do it. And then I ask them the question that each time, first you read, second time you heard, third times you saw, heard, did you find the difference in the meaning? The answer promptly comes yes. And here it goes. Verbal is 8%, vocal is 37%, and visual is 55%. That prompts me to tell that during the interaction with our teams, interaction with our clients, interaction with our colleagues, peers, we have to be emotion exhibit consciousness. And what does that mean? That whatever emotions you want to be displayed on your face, you should be in your control, and not your emotions should control your face. What I mean by that is that obviously, if your words and if your expressions do not match, that will be an authentic communication. But to what extent you want to let your emotion flow is going to be in your control. One. Second, we deal from a situation into other situation. Let's say first situation was not so good and we have felt miserably bad about it. So that invariably reflects into our next interaction. How do you do this shut off and shut down kind of a thing? That's another intelligence, emotional intelligence as they call it. And this is where I am trying to prompt at an emotion exhibit consciousness. Third, official communication. Particularly written ones. They are like boomerangs and they are irrevocable. And if you write the words, the person who is reading is going to, you are communicating only 8% of the meaning. Depending on his mood and the last interaction you had with him, the other 92% of the meaning is going to be interpreted. So you have to be very, very careful. I always request my team members to write facts in the mails, not the feeling. Obviously, the choice of word is very important. And this is a funny thing, but it is true. The male ego, M-A-I-L, male ego. Three sense checks before click send. First, have I written down all I wanted to write down in the way I wanted to write down? That's the first thing which comes in. The second, I don't want to, when I'm replying back, I don't want to get trapped into the I don't want to fall into this escalation entrapment, which normally happens. If he has written to my boss, I will write to his boss and his boss's boss. And restrict this reply all mails. They are all actually waste of time. People who is reading, waste of the memory space of computer. And that's where this six prompt face to face. Preferably, this means that wherever possible, whenever possible, actually or virtually, get onto a face-to-face communication. If not, at least on pick up a telephone. So many a times, rather than replying a mail, quickly calling a person on phone and confirming that yes, we talked about it and the issue is closed is much better an option than replying back and getting into a unnecessary loop of communication. The seventh mindset prompt is G2G or go to Gemba. This is adopted from Toyota's 12 principles. Gemba in Japanese, in place of Japanese, meaning place of work. The UDE, the undesirable effect of actual and virtual review. So most of our managerial time is getting consumed into actual or virtual reviews, meetings. So this leads to 3C virus, which invariably I think you will more than agree with me. The first C is computer, second C is chair, and the third C is the cell phone. So this is the second time in this, and UDE of the actual and virtual review is the Gemba is neglected completely. And most of the information are perceived from others' observation. So the solution is go to Gemba more often than not. It can be a regular and planned kind of a visit. It can be sudden and surprise. And essentially make it a point, when you go to Gemba, speak to Gemba. Now speaking to Gemba is making very powerful observation. I'm coming from an automobile industry's background. So if I am there in front of a bin of a component, I will speak to the component. And the component will tell a lot of the component, will tell that, okay, hey, here, I got a variation from my counterpart who is lying at that corner in that bin. Oh, I got a dent here. My surface is not good enough. Well, look, my edges have not been rounded off. A lot of burrs on me. So this dialogue, this conversation, monologue, or whatever you want to call it, this conversation with your Gemba and the components of Gemba would give you insights into a lot of things which you will not be getting by talking and reviewing. And ultimately, the get gifts of seeing is believing, hands-on information. And most importantly, that will be ensuring that you are connecting with your people and you are releasing the oodles of energy out of this engagement. I use a formula in other presentation, which is E is equal to MC square, which is engagement equals motivation into communication square. A pat on back, a simple thank you for somebody's good work when you are on Gemba rounds can make wonders, and it can release the oodles of people energy, the engagement energy, which will be really, really helpful for the tasks to be performed, the project to be completed, the product to be delivered, processes to be accomplished, and all that kind of stuff. Let me end with this epilogue. MU7, the seven mindset prompts, are amply articulated and subtly stitched for stimulating thoughts, creating habits, building a basic culture, though, of error-proof self-management. They are unique in nature, but at the same time, they truly complement each other. They attempt to apprise progressive rule requirements for effective, efficient, empathetic, and smart task delivery. And all these tasks would, or these steps would result into process, the task would result into a project, and the task would also deliver a product. The MU7 prompts is a prompt, is a MU7 is a mantra for mindful and meaningful adoption by everyone individually and by ecosystems collectively, till it is infused in subconsciousness or subconscious and it is reflected in reflections. Let me end with this wonderful scripture from Upanishad, which I like very much. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. It goes to mean there is a completeness on that side, there is a completeness on this side. The completeness is manifested out of the another completeness. Whatever completeness you borrow out of another completeness, whatever is left over in the earlier completeness is a completeness itself. If this is the state of mind and this is the state of work ethos, I think there'll be a wholehearted happiness everywhere. So there always exists for everyone enough and more. God bless, all the best, and I wish you a wonderful evening after this time, plus healthy time in this particular situation for next about 1.5 months, maybe 15 days, I don't know. And a good health and a good life in all the times to come. Thank you so much. You have been a very patient and kind recipient. Thank you so much. Any questions?
Thank you, Dineshi. Thank you so much for such a nice presentation and enlightening us.